You know, I was talking about this in Sunday school class earlier, and I said, I can't forget to mention this. And of course, I got up and I shared some of those prayer requests earlier, and I forgot again. That's what happens with this right here, just so that you know. I want you to remember that we have a vacancy on the praise team this week. Many of you know, and some of you probably don't know, that Liz Meyerly was in the hospital this last week with just some issues that she was having breathing. And she had 3 stents put in this last week, and they call what she had the widowmaker. Many of you probably have heard of that term before. They found a blockage on the backside of her heart, and it was only because of extensive evaluation that they were able to find it. She's at home recovering today and doing remarkably well, but she could sure use your prayers as well. So would you just add that to your list, as it happened late in the week and we didn't get it in the bulletin? Well, with that being said, I just want to take some time now to let you know that as we go through this series together, we're talking about the life of David, and we're talking about the things that David needed in his life. And last week we talked about the fact that not only David needed it, but we need Goliath in our life. We need those moments in our life where we are reminded of the great and mighty God that we serve, and that he is better and he is bigger than all of our fears or even the biggest trees that fall on us. He is just that big of a God. He loves us that much that he always provides and he always protects. He cares so much for us. And I hope that last week spoke to your heart in regards to that. But I want you to know too that as I was preparing for this series, I kind of marked this week as a week that I knew that I needed to clarify some things to you. And that is simply this. Today's message is going to be one of those messages that I am sure that some of you are going to walk out of the building today and you're going to say, man, that message that Pastor Dave gave today was a bunch of fluff. And for those of you who don't know what fluff is, it's kind of watered down. It's not really deep theological. And I want you to know today that if you walk away with that thought in your mind, then I have not done justice for what I need to say to you today. Or maybe you just have chosen to harden your heart. And I pray that it's more going to be more my fault than yours. Here's what I do know. If you read the sign when you were coming in this morning, you may have noticed, or you saw in your bulletin, that it said that we, you and I, David, needed a Jonathan in his life. Now, maybe you don't know who Jonathan is, and so I want to talk about that this morning. One of the things that happened in David's life and in David's time is that there was this thing called a covenant. And many of us don't talk about covenants today. It's sometimes done in a written form in our day. But back in David's day, if you made a covenant with somebody, it was something that was very visible. You would give to somebody something that was valuable to you. Not what was left over, not what was on the top shelf of your garage that was getting a lot of dust, but it was something that was very valuable to you. And you would give that to someone else, and you would make a covenant. It would be a way for you to say to that person that there is meaning in this relationship that we have. And that's the way it was in David's day. Well, what happened was that with Jonathan, he was so incredible. Jonathan was the son of King Saul. So during the time that King Saul was king, David was just part of the army. David was one of the captains of the army. He did what King Saul said. But for a guy like Jonathan, he had a very unique situation. You see, Jonathan was kind of the next king in line. You know, after King Saul, whatever happened to King Saul, whether it was death or through the battle or death just through natural causes, Jonathan would be the next king. And in our day, that would not be a bad gig at all. In fact, there are a lot of you would say, man, if I was the son of the king and I didn't have to do a whole lot, I'm just going to be the next king, you probably would feel pretty good about that. In fact, you would probably feel so good about that that you probably wouldn't want to relinquish that to somebody else. You'd want to keep that blessing for yourself. That would not be one of those covenant things that you would give to somebody else. But that's just the opposite of what Jonathan did. In fact, Jonathan stripped his robe and gave it to David. He gave him his armor, his sword, he gave him his bow, and he gave him his belt. In a sense, he was saying that God is going to use you, David, in a powerful way as you go out and you fight the battles on behalf of the Lord. Now, you got to understand that if you're in that situation and you are Saul, you got to imagine that that would probably make you feel uncomfortable unless you saw things the way that someone like Jonathan would see them. But see, Saul did not feel that way. In fact, what would happen would be is that David would be out fighting the battles and these things would happen and David would get all the praise and all the glory and people would just shout his name. So much so than Saul would receive from people. And when that happens, like in our day, well, Saul became a little jealous. And Saul sought to kill David. And you can imagine if you are Jonathan, the son of Saul, what a very odd predicament that you are in. This is your father, King Saul, and yet you are seeing David and you know that he is the anointed one of God. And Jonathan loved David so much. In fact, I got to be honest with you. Jonathan recognized so much that David was the anointed one that even through all the things that happened, if he heard of something that was bad, he would let David know. If Saul was going to do something, he would make sure that David would know because he was providing protection for David. Even in anything that would go wrong, he was always there for David. In fact, I've often said that Jonathan was like this shelter tree for David. He was that place, he was that person that would always provide protection to David. He was a safe port in a harbor where you didn't have to worry about the waves or the winds because you knew that with Jonathan, you were going to be okay. You see, he invested his life, Jonathan did, in such a way that God's best would take place through the life of David, not through his own life. But God's best would take place through the life of David, who would take his place on the throne. And that is powerful, folks. So God's best for your life and God's best for my life requires that added ingredient of a Jonathan. Now, you know what I'm going to tell you now is this. Some of you are already starting to say, you know what? This whole Christian thing, this is about me and Jesus. I don't need other people. In fact, Pastor Dave, let me just say privately to you, every Sunday you ask me to shake hands with somebody else in the congregation. I just don't like that because I don't need to know about other people. I just want you to know that you and I need a Jonathan. In these next moments, could we just take just a moment right now? Let us pray. And let us just seek God right now and what it is that he might want to say to you, wherever you are in that whole scenario, how your view is of friends and godly friends. I pray that you'll walk away today knowing that you so desperately need that in your life. So let me pray for you right now. Father, this morning is so hard for so many. Father, we know that you created us in such a way that we thrive and we hunger for relationship. We need relationship with you. And we need relationships with others. And Father, even in those moments when we don't think that we need it at all, I pray, Lord, that you would just convict us. That you would remind us that David could never become the man that he was without a Jonathan. And Lord, in some ways, I don't think that we can become the men and the women that you want us to be without those Jonathans in our life. And so, Father, right now in these moments, Lord, convict us. Help us to see how you see, that we might hunger and thirst for more of that. We ask it in your precious name. Amen. Well, God's best for our lives require a Jonathan in our lives because God says, you know what? You and I, we are all part of the members of God. We're all part of the body of God. It doesn't mean that we're all the same. It doesn't even mean sometimes that we think the same. In fact, it would be great if you guys could just think the way that I think, but that's never going to happen. And because it's never going to happen, I'm not going to think the way that you think. But there is something about being a part of the body of Christ that brings unity to us, even in spite of those things. In fact, we can't stand alone. We know that we can't stand alone. In fact, you look back from the very beginning of time when God created Adam, you realize, don't you, that God didn't look at Adam and say, you know what, Adam, you're a half a man. He didn't say that. But he recognized, he knew, it wasn't something that took God by surprise. But God understood that Adam needed a relationship in his life. I'm not saying that he needed to have a wife. That's what he got. But he needed a relationship in his life. He needed that desperately. And that's the reason why God looked and said, it is not good for man to be alone. That he needed the relationship of other people. Now, some of you say, well, Pastor, wait a minute. I have a comment about that because we know why God said that we needed to have other relationships, because how could we ever populate the world if it wasn't that way? I'm not saying that that's the reason why. There was so much more to it than just that. That was just a small little piece of the whole thing. In fact, I've been sharing all morning with every little group that I've met with. I've shared the same story, and now I want to share it with all of you. It's something that we're not going to look at today. We're not even going to go there in our passage. But I am going to ask you in your notes to write this down. I'm going to ask you to go back and refer to this later on, and it will take you all of about 2 minutes to read it for yourself. So if you just write this passage down, I would so appreciate it. Write down 1 Kings chapter 4, beginning with verse 1, and read the next 6 or 7 verses. That's all I'm asking you to do. If you want to understand how valuable it is to have a Jonathan in your life, you only have to turn to 1 Kings chapter 4. Now, I'm going to tell you the story, then I want you to go and find it for yourself, okay? So here is Solomon, okay, the son of David, and he is about to become king. Now, when a president takes over and he begins his term, you know, he puts together his cabinet, right? So he has his Secretary of Defense. He has this person, that person. He has all these different responsibilities that he's going to give. These come to people that he deems important in his life, right? That happens all throughout our government all the time. Solomon is about to become king, and he begins to go down the list, right? He begins to go down these lists of names of people that you probably don't know and probably cannot even pronounce their names. He comes down and he says, oh, by the way, all of you are wondering what role you're going to play while I am king. You're all in the room waiting. Now I'm going to invite you in. He brings them into this room, and he begins to point to them one by one and describing to them what they are going to do. And so he does that. He says, you're going to be the head of the house. You're going to be the head of the military. You're going to be the head of this. And oh, by the way, he gets to this one name, and I want you to find it when you're reading through it. It's Zabud. He says to Zabud, and here's your responsibility. You're going to be my friend. Now, wait a minute. If you're Zabud, you're saying, wait a minute. Okay, I'm your friend, but what role do I have, and what's my position, and what's my title? And Solomon says, nope, you're my friend. But what am I supposed to do? You're my friend. Solomon felt so compelled to make a friend a part of his team that he made the position just to have a friend. Now, that may not sound like a big deal to you, but if you are king and you are looking at the people who are going to help you influence the world, you look at a guy like Zabud and you said, okay, you don't have any other responsibility except you're going to be my friend. Now, folks, I don't know. I'm not Solomon, but he's one of the smartest people in the Old Testament. And he saw the value in a friendship of one man. And I want you to know today that if that's what God thought that we needed, if that's what God thought Solomon needed, if that's what he thought Adam needed, if that's what he thinks that you need, you ought to feel the same way. I can't go into a lot of detail right now, but I can tell you that I am so blessed. I am so blessed to be here for 17 years in ministry. And maybe part of it is because I haven't messed up yet, and that's a good thing. And you haven't got tired of me yet, and God has not convicted my heart to leave. And all those things are so very true. But can I just tell you real quickly before we get into the heart of the message, I want to say to you this morning, as I said to my Sunday school class and to my prayer group this morning at 8:15, you know one of the greatest joys that I have right now in my life about being the pastor here at MPMC is that I'm looking into this congregation and I think to myself, I have so many friends. I have so many people who love me so much, who would stop whatever they were doing to help me if I was in need. And I think in so many ways that I think you know that about me to you as well. And I think, God, of all the things that you have given me here, you have given me the friendship of other believers, of other men and other women who I can depend upon and help me in my life as I grow closer to you. I pray that you have that in your life too. So this morning, here's the deal. Getting into the text and what we're talking about today. How do we become Jonathan? And how do we find Jonathans in our life? Really, I want you to think this about yourself. How do you become a Jonathan? There are a few things that I want to suggest to you this morning as we look at scripture. And here's the first. The first thing that you need to learn is this. You need to learn to become friendly. Don't you think that that's an important thing to have in your life? Let me say, here's the part where I start talking about, Pastor, this is where the fluff starts. You know, because you just need to be friendly. You just need to get along. No, no. You need to understand there is a mentality, there is something about you and about me that we need to learn to become friendly people. When I have couples that come in my office who are married and they're struggling in their relationship with one another, I don't have to ask a question. I can see that they are not very friendly. They're not very friendly toward each other. And they're a whole lot more friendly toward others who don't matter as much as they do to each other, which is such a sad commentary. And you might say, well, that's just people who are married. I see it in single people as well. There are some of you who maybe there was a time in your life, or there's some of you who know people who are single right now. And you know what? If you were to look at the core of who they are and you wonder why there are no relationships in their life, it's because they're just not very friendly. And you know that about them. And there is something that I think that needs to be said this morning about how you and I look at ourselves and ask the question, how friendly am I? How do I treat other people? Folks, it is important. In fact, let me just read to you Proverbs chapter 18, verse 24. This is the King James Version. It's not the NIV, so it's going to read just a little bit differently than what maybe your NIV version says. But let me just read it to you right now. It says, a man that hath friends must show himself friendly. If you want to have friends, you need to show yourself to be a friendly person. And how do you do that? There's three different ways. This is going to be important. If you have your notes this morning, please write these down, because I can tell right now you need this, okay? And so do I. Here's the first thing. You need to focus on your character, not necessarily on your compatibility. Let me say that again. You need to focus on your character far more than you need to focus on your compatibility with other people. You know what the problem is that you and I look for someone who agrees with the way that we think. You know what? That's how we develop friendships. Because if you think the same way I think politically, we're going to get along a lot better. If you think the same way I look at things when it comes to finances, or, you know, how we give credit, or what kind of food you like, or the activities that you're in that you love to do, you tend to be around people who are a lot like you. People who are a lot like me. And let me just say, for myself, I'm not speaking of you because maybe you feel differently. I don't. And probably you don't need another clone of you. How many of you would like one more of you? That's exactly right. It's about becoming more, not like each other. It's becoming more like Jesus. You see, our character is not the kind of character that the world speaks of. We need to focus on the character of who we are, and that character should be that of Jesus Christ who lives in us. Because it's in those moments that your character, when it becomes like Jesus, changes everything. Can I just tell you that when my wife and I were first married, when I look back at all the struggles that we had in that very first year of our marriage, the problem was that my wife was not like me. She didn't think like me. She didn't talk through disagreements like me. And guess what? I didn't think like her. And I didn't walk through disagreements like she walks through them. And all the time, I thought if she could just be more like me, we would get along in our marriage. I could just fix this problem so easily. But you know, it wasn't until we got to that point that we decided that our character in Jesus Christ would always rule and overrule no matter how we looked at things differently. Because when we became more like Jesus, we, even though we didn't like the same foods and we didn't handle issues the same way, we still were loving on each other and caring for each other because we had the character, not of ourselves, but the character of who Jesus Christ was. And let me tell you, your character matters so much more than your compatibility. It's about being more like Christ. The second thing that you need to know, you need to learn to become encouragers. We all do. We all need it, don't we? When we stop and we really think about it, I think that if you could just imagine this for just a moment, I know that you're not going to say it. And for all the macho men in the room who never cry, you know, your hands are strong. And, you know, unlike, there's a little joke that goes around. I've got soft hands, soft feet, soft heart, soft eyes. Everything about me feels a little soft these days as I get older. I don't have those strong hands anymore. Can I just tell you that there's something, no matter where you are on that spectrum, there's a sign that's over your neck and you don't even see it. But it's there. And this is what that sign says. It says simply this. It says that, please help me. I need to feel valuable. Please help me. I need to feel valuable. We need to look at other people and let them know that they are valuable. Not just that we have something special, but they have something special to give as well. And now here's the part, right? Because that's fluff to you, right? That's just me up here saying, you know what? Let's just gather hands together and let's sing Kumbaya together. And no matter what happens, we're just going to get along. No, no, no. We need to be people who look at other people and say, you are valuable. Because we all need to hear it. Fluff or no fluff, it's true. The third thing is this. We need to speak well of others. You know what? This is the worst thing that I think about. It comes to my mind all the time. In our world, we always train our eyes to look and to see what is wrong, don't we? I got to tell you, I'm not even going to play around about it. There are certain networks that I cannot stand to listen to. I can't even turn the TV to the channel. It drives me crazy, and I get really angry. I'll turn it on at 5 o'clock, and I'll get angry at the local news, or the national news. And then maybe at 10 o'clock, I'll listen to the local news, and I'll get angry again. And then I'll go to bed, and I'll have a bad dream because now I'm mad about what my dream was about. I wake up in a bad mood, and then the rest of my day is a bad day. And you know why? Because I look and see what is wrong instead of what is right. You're always going to see what you're looking for. You're always going to see what it is that you're looking for. And you will always find it every single time. So speak well of others as well. I'm not saying that you shouldn't call sin what it is. I'm not saying that you shouldn't deal with the hard things. You should. But every once in a while, we ought to find what is good and what is right. Here's the second thing that we need to understand, too, about becoming a Jonathan. We need to deepen our present relationships. When I say present relationships, let me explain what I mean by that. It is so easy for us to develop friendships with other people. And then when things don't work out and it gets a little tense, we are quick just to dispose of those people and find somebody else. It's so easy just to cut off the relationships. It's so easy to do that. But 1 Corinthians chapter 13, it's starting with verse 4 and 5. It's a passage that I use all the time when I do counseling with couples, especially premarital counseling. This is what it says. It says, love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. And it keeps no records of wrong. And if you read a little bit further, it says this, and love never fails. Because see, when you put love into the equation of relationships, you don't just have to cut that relationship off every time a problem comes your way. You don't have to do that. In fact, Proverbs chapter 27, verse 6 tells us this, wounds from a friend can be trusted, but an enemy multiplies kisses. It is okay from time to time for there to be wounds in a relationship. It's okay from time to time that you don't see the way that your friend sees things. Wounds in our life, folks, can be for the good, believe it or not. If you get to have a friend, if you get to that point that you have friends like that, you're going to get wounded. If you have a relationship for any period of time, it is going to be wounded. There are going to be times that you are going to struggle, but you don't just cut it off. In fact, it reminds me of a story when I was in high school. It was actually middle school. I went to Wakarusa Middle School. I don't know if any of you know where that's at, but we had a cinder track. It wasn't like these nice tracks today. It was full of cinders. And I did hurdles, and my foot got caught on a hurdle, and I tripped over it. And when I fell, all these cinders just piled up inside of my skin of my knee. And I was just bleeding all the way down my leg. And just like today, pain is not my friend. And man, I was on death's door. I'm sure that I was dying at that very moment. And my coach took me to the trainer. And the trainer looked at it and he says, you know what we're going to have to do? We're going to have to clean it. And I said, what? We're going to have to clean it. I wasn't a big fan of the trainer, just so that you're aware up front. But when he got out the brush, and I'm sure that it was not just a soft bristle brush. It was hard. And he started raking it across my knee. And it hurt. And you know what I wanted him to do? I actually said, just cut the skin off and I will feel a whole lot better. You don't have to sit there and keep taking that brush across it. He says, we have to. It is the only way for it to heal. And you know, when I stop and I think about that today, sometimes in relationships we get wounded. We just want to cut it off and find something else. But you know, you can only do that for a little while. You can only do that for a little while before you find out you have no parts left. You do it for a little. It's like the guy who lives out in the woods and he has a cabin. And he doesn't cut down any trees for the winter. So he starts taking off wood off the side of his cabin for firewood to get through the winter. You can only do that for a little while before there is nothing left. And folks, when it comes to relationships, it's the same thing. You can't just cut them off. Couples, you just can't cut each other off. Friendships, you just can't cut them off. You got to clean them. And you've got to be mean sometimes when you do it. And you may not like them in the moment that you're going through it. But when it's over and done, my knee felt just fine. And so will relationships. It's not easy, but it's worth it. Life is not a comfort zone. You have to go through the wounds of life too. Here's the third thing. Don't look for someone who is valuable. Know how valuable you are. Let me say that again. Don't look for someone who is valuable. Know how valuable you are. You're wondering, how does this apply to Jonathan? Let me tell you how it applies to Jonathan. Here's how it applies. Jonathan loved David as much as he loved himself. Huh. That sounds like something that somebody else said. When Jesus said, this is how I want you to live. I want you to love the Lord your God with all your heart. And oh, by the way, the second commandment is as important. It's as valuable as the first. And that is to do this. Love your neighbor as yourself. Wow. You know why it's so important that you look for someone else's value rather than, and really, truly, at the end of the day, know how valuable you are? Let me explain it. Just so you know how much Jonathan loved David, 1 Samuel chapter 20, verse 17 says this. And Jonathan had David reaffirm his oath out of love for him because he loved him. He loved him as much as he loved himself. You got to know how valuable you are. If it were not only you, if it was only you in the world, can I just say this to you right now? You may not know how valuable you are, but let me say to you this morning how valuable you really are. If you were the only person in the world, may I say to you this morning that Jesus would have done the same thing on the cross for you alone as he would do for all of us. That's how valuable you are. And when you find that, you're never going to be able to give value to others if you're constantly fighting for that for yourself. You'll keep it for yourself. You'll look for every conversation to find value for you. You'll look for every situation to give credit to you. But when you understand that you are valuable, it is so much easier for you and I to put value on other people. There's a lot of people who are looking for validation for their life, who want to feel valuable, and they never quite get to that point, and they're always sucking it for themselves from the relationship that they're in. Whether it's a husband or wife or a friendship, they constantly want more for themselves and just keep pulling it in. And God says, if you really want to know what it means to be a Jonathan, you need to understand how valuable you are. And let me say to you, the reason why Jonathan loved David as much as he loved himself was because Jonathan knew he was valuable. Not David, though David was valuable, he knew that he was valuable in the story of David's life as well. Jonathan didn't have to wonder, couldn't I have been a better king? He didn't think about that. He didn't think about, I could be a better ruler. I could be better for the people. No, he didn't think like that. He just knew that David was God's anointed and he got to play a part in that because he was valuable. Folks, that's what it means for you and for me too. Nobody makes you whole, okay? Only God does. When I do premarital counseling, I hate to talk about premarital counseling, but when I do premarital counseling, I know that there are couples when they walk in the room, they say, you know what, he fulfills me, or she fulfills me. You know, I'm like 50%, I'm half a person, and he's half a person, and when we got married, now we're whole. Can I just say, yes, when you stand before God, you become one, but you are whole. You, in all of you are as a woman, all you are as a man, you are whole. You just get to complement each other. You get to become one, but you're not half a person. God did not create you to be half a person. Nobody makes you whole. No man and no woman makes you whole except Jesus Christ. And if you want... Here's the thing you need to understand. If you come into a marriage or into a relationship thinking that that person's going to complete me, you're not going to marry a spouse. You're going to marry an expectation. You're going to marry something that you think is going to finally give me what I need, and you don't need that. You are marrying a spouse. You're marrying a whole person just like you're a whole person. And I hope that we never forget that. Daniel chapter 7, verse 25 tells us that he's speaking of the devil. Listen carefully to this, because this is the biggest problem that we talk about when it comes to being a Jonathan. This is what happens over the course of life. Daniel talks about this when he speaks of Satan. He says, he will speak against, talking about Satan, he will speak against the Most High and oppress, or he will wear down his holy people and try to change the set times and the laws. Now, we're just going to stop right there, because that's exactly what he's talking about. He's saying that over time, you know what Satan does? This is what Satan does. It's like in David's day when you would have a coin. And let's say that coin was an ounce, and it had the figure of a king on it. Well, when you would go to use that coin, when you would go out to buy goods, or you would go to a merchant and you would buy stuff, what they would do is that they wouldn't just take the coin and give you change back. If this coin that you had was an ounce, they would take your coin and they would put it on what? You know what they put it on? They put it on a scale. And they would have an ounce on the one side. They put your coin on another side to make sure that that coin had an ounce worth of gold or whatever that was in it. And if it didn't, you had to use things like shekels or something like that to add to it. Now, if you thought that this was an ounce, what happened to it? How did the coin lose its power or its amount? Over time, that coin would be handed from one person to the next person to the next person, and it would slowly lose its value because it would slowly use the mass of that coin. That's exactly the way Satan does. He uses life. He uses this situation and then that situation and then that situation. And over the course of time, you know what Satan does? He tries to wear you down. That's what he tries to do. And that's why you're always looking for validation. You're always looking for credit. You're always looking for what is in it for me in this relationship. And if I don't like the relationship, I just cut it off and I find a new one. That's what Satan wants. He wants you to cut it off. He wants you to forget about it. He wants to wear you down. Some of you need to know how valuable you are. Some of you need to know that you have such value in the eyes of God that it's not even funny. Now, I've got a great story as we finish today. I had a friend who, he liked money. There's just no other way around it. He was all about how to make another dollar. And his wife was given this pearl necklace. The necklace came from her grandma. And she said this necklace was so very valuable. And she could never part with it. Well, one day she had it laying on her table. And my friend, being the guy that he was, decided that he was going to, for her, take the pearl necklace and take it to a place where it could be evaluated and he could find out just how much it was really worth. Because in his mind, he thought, if he could just find out and he could take it back to her, surely she would sell it to get the money, because the money would be so worth so much more than just the pearl necklace that her grandma gave her. So that's exactly what he did. And he told me about this when he got back, because I think it was a day or so before he gave her the 411 on what he had done. And he says, yeah, he said, I took this thing and I had it appraised. And he said, the guy looked at it, he says, yeah, it's really nice, but it's a cosmetic piece. It was worth how much? He says, well, it's really nice. Well, how much though? $30, maybe. He thought, great. My wife has hung onto this thing and hung onto this thing, and all it's worth is a lousy $30. He says, I can't wait to tell my wife about this wonderful pearl necklace that she thought she had. He came back to me and he told me her response later on. He said, honey, I got some bad news. You know that beautiful pearl necklace that you got from your grandma that was so valuable? She said, yeah. He goes, well, I had it appraised, and it's worth all about $30. And he expected her mouth to drop. He expected for her to be disappointed. And you know she wasn't. And you know why? She looked at him and she said, you know what, Dwayne? Well, I better be careful. You know what? It was really John. Yeah, something like that. You know what, Dwayne? That necklace is so valuable, not because of what it's worth monetarily, but it was whose hands it was in. Amen. It was in the neck that wore it, because grandma was a person of character. My grandma was a person who gave of herself to everybody. It may be worth $30 in society, but it's priceless to me. And can I tell you, relationships, the Jonathans of this world are absolutely priceless. When you find it, you hang on to it. You fight through the wounds and you clean it up, because it is worth it in the end. I promise you. Jonathan never looked back on his life with regret. Let me tell you. David became king and he ruled and he ruled. But Jonathan knew that he was doing exactly what God wanted for him, because Jonathan was valuable in the eyes of God. And I'm looking at every person in this room, and I want you to know that in the eyes of God, and not just in God's eyes, you are valuable. He made you in his image for a purpose. I don't want us to ever forget that. I don't want us to ever stop building those kinds of relationships, because at the end of the day, as we all get older and we look back on life, our priorities change so much. It's not about the stuff as we get older. For those of you who are fairly young, trust me, you're not going to care when you're 85 years old how many boats or how many cars you have. You're going to care a whole lot about relationships, though. And the good ones, the ones that last the test of time. Spiritually, oh, I need you. Relationally, I need you. I look forward to shaking some hands. I look forward to the visits that come in the office unexpected and just to say hello. When there's a need and I'm struggling, I don't have to worry. I can pick up a phone call and I can call 100 people right here in this room. And I know exactly what I would get. I have a small group that I meet with, and there's such love that pours out every time that we meet. There are people that I met only because your mother attended. And now we love you too. I'm so grateful for what God gives to us. I hope that you know how meaningful you are to me. And I hope you know how much I love you too. I pray that we will always look to be the Jonathans more than we will look to be the Davids. Because there's something special about those people. So this morning, would you stand with me? And this morning, let it just be a time for us to be thanking God for the opportunity that he sets before us every day. And maybe, just maybe, you'll be a little more friendly. Not just here, but when you go to Walmart, that will be truly your test, I promise you. But beyond Walmart too, there's a test for you and me. And I think we can live up to that test. Not because we're all compatible, but because of our character. That you'll view others and you'll give them the value that they deserve, just like you want them to give the value to you that you deserve. Don't let Satan wear you down. Don't let life go by and get bitter because of all the things that have happened over the course of your life. You know, sometimes as we get older, I see folks get bitter more than they get better. And that's not discredit to them. It's just simply that they have gone through so many stages of life. More relationships, more tension, more wounds. And sometimes it's just easy to see all the bad. But there's so much good. And it's because of those relationships with the Jonathans. Let's sing together this morning. Biblically, back this up with scripture. But I believe that if Jonathan could have a theme song, that would be his song. You're a good, good father, and I am your child, and you love me. It is his theme for how he lived out his life. I know, God, you are going to use me. And God, I know you love me. And that is all that I need in my life. So David, become king. Rule and overrule. Be the line that the Messiah comes through. And that is okay. Because you're a good, good father. And you love me. And that is enough. What it says to you and what it says to me is this. He's a good, good father. And you are his child. And he loves you. And you are valuable in his eyes. Because he created you in his image. Don't forget it. Father, thank you so much. Thank you for just loving us in ways that we can't begin to fathom or to reach. The depths of your love are beyond anything we can begin to understand. That you valued us so much that you made us different than every other part of creation. You made us in your image, and you made us in a way that reflects who you are. And Father, this morning, because you are a good, good Father who has our best interests in mind, we can be called children of God. and we get to be loved by the Father just like a great father loves their child. So Father, today we can take a back seat to anybody for the purpose of your will to be done. That Father, that we can give credit to somebody else easy because we don't have to have more credit for ourselves because we know just how valuable we are. We know how much you love us. So Father, this morning, let us walk away today with the heart of Jonathan. Let us walk away today seeking for ways to show others that they are valuable and that they have a purpose. Let us love on each other. Let people see that and let it be so different than anything they've ever seen before, that they hunger and they thirst for something like that. Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus, our Lord and our Savior. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful day in the Lord.